This video is being brought to you with the support of the channel sponsor, PCBWay. I'm actually using a PCB that I had assembled by them in this project. I'll be making some more PCBs in the future videos as I want to learn a bit more about KiCad. They also do 3D printing and CNC work. Check out the link to PCBWay in the description. So we're back with a bit of audio. We've played back audio in plenty of previous videos. Check out the audio projects playlist I've linked to in the description. So you might be asking, what's new in this video? Well, in previous videos, we've been playing back uncompressed audio, either raw samples or WAV files. This time, we'll be playing back an MP3 audio file. So what's so great about playing back MP3 files? Well, when we're dealing with the ESP32, size does matter. Size of the audio files, that is. Typically, on the ESP32, we're limited by the size of the flash storage. On most ESP32 devices, this is about 4 megabytes, and you do need to reserve some of that for your actual firmware. With a small app partition and over-the-air update support, you can get almost 2 megabytes of SPIF storage. If you don't need over-the-air updates, then you can get closer to 3 megabytes for SPIFs, but as your app grows in size, you'll need to decrease the amount of space you've allocated to storage. If you're dealing with audio data, it quickly takes up a lot of space. If we have stereo audio sampled at 44.1 kHz with 16-bit samples, then every second of audio data takes up about 172 kilobytes. If we've got around 1 megabyte spare on our flash for audio data, we can only store 5 or 6 seconds worth of audio. Now, a normal single is around 3.5 minutes long, and would require about 35 megabytes to store uncompressed. Obviously, this is not going to fit in a SPIFS partition. There are, of course, some shorter songs. The Guinness World Record for the shortest song ever published is 1.3 seconds. I've put a link to it in the description for you to have a listen. So, assuming you want to listen to something that lasts more than 1.3 seconds, we'll need to compress the audio. MP3 is a popular compression technique for audio files and can compress the audio down to 75-95% of its original size. It became popular back in the mid to late 90s with services like Napster taking off. I've run a fairly short song through various different bit rates to see how well it performs. The song is only 2 minutes 41 seconds long, so only takes up around 28 megabytes in WAV format. As we decrease the bitrate the audio is encoded at, we decrease the file size dramatically. Even on the very low setting of 45 to 85 kilobits per second, the quality is still very good, and we're down to less than a megabyte in size. With MP3 decoding, we can fit a song into SPIFs reasonably easily. Obviously, if you wanted more than one song, you'd probably need to switch to an SD card for storage. But even for short audio samples, encoding them as MP3 would give you a massive saving in space. So how do we actually decode the MP3 data? I found a very nice standalone MP3 decoder that is self-contained in a single header file. We just need to feed this data from the MP3 file, and it will give us 16-bit audio samples to play. The decoder decodes one frame of data at a time from the buffer and tells us how much data it has consumed. We shift the data down by this number of bytes and top the buffer up from a file. We keep running this until we have no more data in the file and all the buffered data has been used up. So how do we play back the audio? Well, I've got two different options for you. We can play the data using the ESP32's built-in analog-to-digital converter and some headphones, or we can output I2S data straight to a digital amplifier. So let's cover the headphone option first. Wiring up headphones is pretty straightforward. You can either get a little breakout board like I have with the headphone socket connected to it, or you can hack up an old set of headphones and connect header pins to the cable. Headphone jacks generally come in a couple of variations. You have some that come with a microphone and some that just have headphones. The tip of the socket is connected to the left earpiece. The first ring is connected to the right earpiece. Most headphones then have the ground connection next, followed by the microphone on the final connector. But be aware, there are some manufacturers such as Nokia who used a different standard and have the microphone on ring 2 and the ground on the sleeve. Our DAC outputs the audio signal with a DC bias, so we need to put a DC blocking capacitor between the signal and the headphone connector. This will block the DC element and only allow through AC signals. The size of the capacitor will determine how well the system responds to low frequency signals. I'm using a couple of 47 microfarad capacitors that I had lying around. I'm not trying to build a high quality audio system. I found the ESP32's DAC output quite capable of driving the headphones, but to make sure I don't damage the ESP32 by drawing too much current, I've put a resistor in series. I found that a value of 500 to 2 kiloohms seems to work well and still gives a reasonable volume. But you might want to play with this value yourself. The DAC output is quite noisy. We can see this on the oscilloscope with the volume turned down to zero. We have audible noise on the headphones. My initial thought was this could be power supply noise, so I tried it with a battery power supply, but the noise still is present. So your mileage may vary, but I found it a little bit noisy, but actually it's quite listenable. So I've recorded some audio as best I can from the headphones. It's annoying that not many computers actually have a line input nowadays, so I've had to use my headphones and strap them round a phone. So let's have a listen. It's actually pretty good. I'm quite pleased with the audio output. The other way to get audio out of the ESP32 is to use the I2S interface connected directly to an amplifier such as the MAX98357. I've got a whole video on using this device, there's a link in the description. Wiring up is very straightforward, we just need three pins on the ESP32. One for the left-right clock, one for the serial clock, and one for the serial data. If we want to have stereo sound, then we do need two MAX98357 boards. One for the left channel and one for the right channel. If you're using the breakout board from Adafruit, then you select the channel on the board by connecting a resistor from the SD pin to the power supply. Calculating this value is a bit complicated. The board has a resistor divider connected to the pin already, so you need to take this into account when calculating your pull-up resistor. I actually got it wrong in the previous video, and you should use a value of around 390 kiloohms. I've got my own stereo breakout board based around the same chip that outputs stereo to two speakers and cuts down on the wiring. I've linked to the design video for that board in the description. The MAX98357 board has a selectable gain. At maximum gain, each amplifier will require over 1 amp. This means that if you are using two amplifiers for stereo sound, then you need about 3 amps in total. Drawing this much current can pull down the voltage coming from the power supply and can cause the ESP32 to brown out if it gets pulled too low. I've connected the voltage coming into the ESP32 dev board from the power supply to my oscilloscope, and we can see the effect here. The voltage is being pulled down by almost 2 volts. Eventually we have a sustained loud piece of music and the ESP32 cuts out due to a brownout and we get a reset. To mitigate this, we can add a bunch of capacitors to the power pins of the amplifier. I have added 3 1000 microfarad capacitors to mine, and now we can get through the whole song at maximum volume. The voltage is still being pulled down, but not as badly as before. So ideally, you'd probably want to use a slightly more powerful power supply, along with some reservoir capacitors near the amplifier. As a bonus, I've added a volume control using a potentiometer connected between 0 volts and the 3.3 volt line. We measure this using the analog to digital converter on the ESP32 and use the measured value to set the volume. There's an interesting thing that's quite important about volume and how we perceive loudness. We don't perceive loudness on a linear scale. So if you are using a linear potentiometer like I am to set the volume, you should make sure to amplify the sound in a non-linear way. You can do this by simply squaring or cubing the volume. This gives a much more pleasing volume control. So that's it for this project. It would be quite easy to hook up an SD card and an ESP32 with a display, and you've got yourself a very rudimentary MP3 player. As always, the code is on GitHub. Let me know how you get on.